morning. I know that not everybody's here yet. Some people are still coming in, and that's wonderful. But we're going to start on time. I just want to have the people on Facebook who are out there know that we start at 10 o'clock. They know that we are starting, and that's wonderful that you're there. So praise God. God bless you this morning. And tell some of your friends to watch with you. Praise the Lord. We are blessed to be here. And as usual, Edna's here to play some music and to bring us into the presence of the Lord. He says where two or three are gathered, that he is here in our midst. And so we certainly have the two or three, and that he is here in our midst. So receive all that the Lord has for you this morning. Amen. Announcements. That's okay.
I think I have to say good morning to myself first. Wake up. Good morning, everyone. God bless you. We'll welcome you today. Hope you're all doing well. If not, you can always let us know. We'll always pray. That's something I know about this church. We are a praying church. Praise God. First of all, just want to let you know, if you want to give by Cash App, that is available. You can do whatever you want with that, but Cash App is something that is very easy to do. If writing a check or doing it the other way is harder. So the password is Community Baptist Norwalk or $CBC Norwalk. If you need help navigating that, just let me know. Pastor and I are very familiar with it because we have 6 grown children and we do Cash App for their birthdays. It's easier than sending a package. Praise the Lord. Let's see. Prayer meeting is Mondays at 5 o'clock. Just call Pastor's phone number, 203-984-0367. If you want to be a part of it, we'll gladly connect you in. We do it by conference call. But also, if you just have a prayer request, just send a text to Pastor or myself, and we'll be sure to bring it up. We see wonderful answers to prayer. We cry, we laugh, we rejoice, we do everything at our prayer group. It's wonderful. So we thank God for that connection. Praise the Lord. Just wanted to remind you that we are on Facebook Live, and we also will be on YouTube. I guess it's a couple hours longer after church. And then the connection goes up for that also. I want to remind you all to invite someone to church, okay? These are difficult times that we really are living in, financially, everything is more expensive, gas, food, electricity, rent, everything. Our own son, who recently moved to a different apartment in Colorado, his rent was going up.
How much was it going up?
It went up $900.
Yeah, $900 more a month. I just said, huh? No wonder he moved, you know. But yeah, there's a lot of problems out there. So we just need to pray for one another. We need to extend help when we can. And you know, just remember, even if you can't help as much as someone else, little as much, when you put it in the Lord's hands, and every little bit helps. Every little bit, okay? And I don't say that just in money. I say opening the door for someone, giving someone a smile. I want to tell you an experience. I am kind of using my freedom here up here with announcements, but I went to the eye doctor the other day, and the secretary's name is Brittany. And a year ago, I had seen her. I don't know how it came about that I got the information, but we were talking, and she told me she had been struggling for a long time to get pregnant. And I said, oh, I'm so sorry for you. I will pray for you. I said, you know, I'll let the people that I know in my prayer group pray. So now, fast forward a year, and I went in to see her, and she was so excited. She's only 6 weeks pregnant. That's not very far along. But she was on top of the world. And I was so excited because I know we prayed for her. And that is a direct answer to prayer. And we need to keep praying for her because 6 weeks is early on. A lot can happen, but we're putting it in the Lord's hands. So her name is Brittany. If you would pray for her, I'd really be thankful for that. Okay? Praise God. Have a good service and have a wonderful day.
Praise God. If you'd open up your hymn books, 351. 351. Stand if you like, sit if you must. Well, my wife jumped ahead and already started giving testimonies, so I'll let you do it. Yeah. But it was a good one. Praise God. Would anybody else have a testimony of what God has done for you? Anybody? Butch.
A couple of praise reports. First of all, Christine and Rick were looking for a new apartment because where they were living was sold and they had to get out. And all this other thing, the four places were sold. I talked to Randy. I said, Randy, I saw Randy at work and asked how it was going. And I'm hoping that they found a location to move into the place.
Amen.
We were praying about it Monday night prayer that we was talking about this prayer. That was one of the things on our list that we were praying about for the end. Other people were places. We know God's going to answer the prayer. I mean, we already did the prayer, and He's going to answer the others too. So we shouldn't worry. A quick little thing also, not a big thing, but it was little things that add up. I had to take my car to the service at the Honda dealership in Fairfield. I had an appointment, I went up there Saturday morning early, wanted to be in and be out. Make a long story short, I go up and they do the paperwork. The man says, okay, looks up the information, says how much it's going to be, what they have to do. I said, fine. He says, oh, he says, by the way, he says, I can give you a coupon, you just want to park towards that. I said, oh, two things, we did that. I told him I needed the file. He needed to put back because that two of them numbers low. I saw it coming up with the battery. He said, oh, okay. He said, well, the battery's usually like $9.95. So, what we did is we made the money. He says, okay, do that. Go inside, I wait about 45 minutes later. My car's on company in service. They call me back. The guy comes up to the bill. He has a big, get the discount coupon, turn around for me, you're charging $35. And on top of it, then he gave me a car wash that was worth about $15. I saved about 40% on the bill. I said, oh, I said, give God the glory. I said, well, I just said, praise you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Little things, but they add up.
Amen. 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 Brandon? Amen. Complete healing with it. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Yes, over there.
August 16th, we celebrated our 3-year anniversary.
Amen. 3 years. Hallelujah. Woo. Time goes by fast. Yes.
Just wanted to say that Pastor had a sinus procedure on Monday, and it all went well, and he's still healing from it, but he's doing really well.
Amen. Tuesday wasn't too good, but it's getting better.
I'm watching him because now the doctor wants to do it to me, and I'm like, no, I don't think so.
Rick?
We leave Thursday to go down to Tennessee for the family reunion. Tennessee was much harder hit than Connecticut by COVID. And we're reading stories of the pastor who had church and caught COVID in church.
Yes.
Several hospitalized. So now we have to ask ourselves, is this really going to be a spreader event? Or is it something that the Lord wants us to do? I tell you, I'll never forget back when the COVID started, there was this priest, and I guess the Catholic Church had ordered that they close their church. And he said, he was on TV and radio, he said, I will not close my church. And if you have to pry the keys out of my COVID-ridden hands, real gospel. I feel like him. It's been 3 years since I saw my family. We keep waiting, we keep saying, it's going to get better. It has gotten better. So I feel in my heart of hearts, we're going to swing out on the promises.
Amen.
Swing out on the promises that God has promised that he will take care of us. And we'll go see your family.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen. Anybody else? Yes. But we were just singing that song this morning, like a sea billow roll, right? My young grandson, Gabe, is only two, and he gets in there and gets knocked over by the waves. He just laughs and gets back up and laughs and gets back up. Like a sea billow rolls, it just rolls over him. Since Jesus came into my heart, I just was looking at that and said, you know, we just praise God. Amen. Yes.
I'll go off of a little bit of what my father said, but although we were sorely missed last week, it was a blessing to see my dad leading the service.
Amen.
And reiterating what he explained about COVID, I'm very blessed that he and my mom are still here. We're not affected by COVID, as well as our extended family.
Amen. 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 Praise God. Anybody else? Well, we have a few prayer requests that have been sent to me. We have two couples that are looking for a bigger apartment and need to get that, so we're praying for that. We have another individual who's looking for a place to move into on a little permanent basis, so we're going to be praying for him, to find the right place. So all of these different things that they're moving through. Everett is not able to be here today, but he has his eye shot. He gets a shot in his eye every month or so. And ever since we've been praying as the church, he says he's not had the pain, because the first shot he got, they didn't pray before the shot, and he had all kinds of problems. But after that, we've been praying, and he says, oh, Pastor, I'm not going to be there on Sunday, but have the church pray for my shot, because it works. And I'm sitting here, praise God. That's positive faith, we believe. So we're praying for Everett's shot this coming Thursday, and that it will help and do what it's supposed to do. No problems. Praise God. What other prayer concerns were called in? I think that was all that I can remember offhand right now. Anybody else have prayer concerns they want to pray for? I know we have a few people that we look right over here. Marge is in the hospital, but she's improving all the time. Supposed to get ready to go to rehab. A little problem with some of the paperwork, so we're praying for that. We have June, who is at home doing physical therapy, and that they're coming in once or twice a week to help her with that. So we're continuing for her healing. Yes?
I need a prayer for Jay for his physical things.
Okay, praying for Jay. Amen. And his his mom also, praying for their healing and strengthening. Yes?
Remember my son Billy in your prayers also. Please lead our prayers.
Okay, keep Billy in prayer. Yes. Amen. Amen. Yes? Okay, so Janet, Tammy, Janet, the regulars, and you are doing well and continuing strength. Okay, praise God. Amen. Yes?
Sorry, Virgin, another testimony is that our son Jason, who is in sales for computer software, but he doesn't do a lot of the selling, he's in a higher position over a lot of other people who do. But anyway, he got the Alliance Partner of the Year award. He went out to Chicago and so forth.
Awesome. Amen. Yes.
Prayers for a friend of mine who just was in an auto accident. And he's on the mend, he's doing better. His car was destroyed there. So just prayers that he can use, right?
Amen. Amen. Your mom and Debbie, yes. Yes.
Chris and Gabby.
Yep.
I still have a lot of problems with pain in your arm. They said it's gone for a while, but I think Jesus is going to be so much better. And we go somewhere or whatever. Now, Chris, you may go over there and start following, but I think he said this Wednesday.
Amen. Chris and Kathy both had surgeries and they're recovering from them. So it's a slow process. Yes?
Prayer for Jeremiah and his adjustment to a new school.
I was just going to say that. Let it go of college kids. Amen. Praying for Jeremiah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes?
Hallelujah. Spiritually as well as physically. Amen. Yes.
Traveling mercies.
Amen. Rick and his family. Amen. Amen. If I don't remember it, hallelujah, God does. We've shared with one another these concerns on our hearts, and these prayers and praises are going up to the Lord. So let's turn our hearts to the Lord right now. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just remember who you are. Our Father who is in heaven, Lord God, we praise your name. We thank you, Lord God. We give you the honor and the glory for who you are. We thank you for our daily bread. We thank you for your daily provision. We thank you, Lord, for the joy that you put in our hearts. We thank you that we can share with one another and that we can share with those who don't even know you, Lord God, that we can pray for those who are in need. Whatever it is, if it's for shelter, if it's for food, if it's for healing, whatever it is, you are the God who hears and answers, Lord God. And Lord God, you have the cattle on a thousand hills, Lord God. And we just thank you, Lord God, that you are able to provide. And Lord God, we just thank you for your presence in our lives, Lord God. We thank you for whatever it is that turns people's hearts to you, Lord God. Let it be something that, Lord, they can see without a doubt. As they have that need and they go to you, Lord God, and they try to see what you can do, Lord God. And we thank you that all things are possible to them who believe. And Lord God, we pray for our unbelief, Lord God, that you would help us, Lord God, to plant that seed, Lord God, that little mustard seed, Lord, of faith. Lord God, that we would say to that mountain, be ye removed, Lord God. So, Lord God, we thank you. We thank you for the faith of the people who asked for prayer, Lord God, for finding places to live and for healing, and Lord God, and with Everett's just testimony of faith, that since he's been asking for prayer ahead of time, that you've just touched him again and again. So Lord, we pray, do it again, Lord God, do it again. We thank you, Lord God, as you minister to each one of us and help us to go out and to pray one for another. Lord God, that we lift up your name and we give you the honor and the glory and the praise, both now and forever. We pray right now for the continuance of this service, Lord God. We pray that you would touch the hearers of this word and touch me and anoint me, Lord God, as I bring forth your word, Lord God. And we know that as I proclaim your word, that it will not return void. I thank you, Lord God, in advance for all that you're doing, Lord God. All that you've done, all that you're doing, and all that you will do, Lord God. We pray that you would meet us in our spiritual need this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, you know, sometimes I start with a portion of scripture that kind of sometimes gets away from me. Instead of getting more refined, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, okay? Basically, my message today is going to be from Romans, and you can open up your Bibles to Romans chapter 12, just verses 9 through 21. But there's going to be a little bit of preface beforehand, so if you hear me going back to the beginning of Romans, okay, I haven't lost my mind, I really haven't, and I haven't given you the wrong place to look, but I want to give you a little preview before we get to the part that the message is all about, okay? So pray for me as we go through this. If we take a look at the book of Romans in general, I was looking at this portion of scripture, and it made me go all the way back to Romans 1. And you realize that in Romans 1, Paul is speaking to them and telling them that we are without excuse, that the creation of the world itself points people to who God is. And the people in the world don't receive it. They don't receive who God is, even though they look at creation. And these days, all this stuff about, you know, oh, you know, green thing and look at the earth and blah, blah. Well, they look at not the creator, they look at the creation. Do you understand the difference? If God created it, it's perfect. If man starts meddling with it, no matter what we do, we can screw it up, you know? He put up in, you know, Adam into the garden, but, you know, it wasn't anything that he did with his high-tech knowledge of how to raise plants and everything. God is God. But it all points to the Creator God, and that we need to know that we can't lean to our own understanding. We can't look to what we think it should be. What is it about this creation that should be pointing us to God? We really need to be reflective of that. In Romans, it's called the Romans Road, okay? There are scriptures, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on them, but Paul brings them through in some passages. In Romans 3:23, it says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Well, a lot of people don't want to say, what do you mean all? You calling me a sinner? Yeah, I'm not. The Bible is. The Word of God is. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In Romans 5:8, it tells us that God demonstrates his love to us, that Christ showed his love for us, that he was crucified before we got saved, while we were yet sinners. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. I don't know about you, but that's pretty spectacular. I didn't do anything to deserve it. He goes on to 6:23. It says, the wages of sin is death. Oh, that's pretty heavy. But it says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Wow. You know, you hit them with the heavy thing. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's a gift. It goes on to 10:9 And it says that if we confess with our mouth, you know, about Jesus, and we believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, that we shall be saved. This plan of salvation is there, and it's so clear, and it goes on. And it goes on to chapter 12. In the very beginning of chapter 12, it says, I urge you to, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living, holy sacrifice. Don't be conformed to the world, be transformed. This is what we need to do as believers. But now we're going to get to the message that I'm going to preach today. All this is leading up to it, that as we are believers, what does a real Christian, or what does the church, the real church, look like in the world today? You know, we need to know that it's not the fact that we should blend in and be a chameleon and look like everybody else. Shh, I'm a secret agent Christian. You know, nobody knows that I'm a Christian. Well, nobody knows you're a Christian. Are you really a Christian? Hello? It says here that we are to be able to stand out and to be different. You know, we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. We're supposed to be different. Well, in the portion of scripture that I'm going to be preaching about today, in Romans 12, 9 through 21, it talks to us about what we should be doing. It doesn't talk about the unsaved. It doesn't talk about the world. It talks about you and me. If we are believers, if we trust Christ as our Savior, if we know Him, what should we be doing? Okay? So take a look at verse 9 with me. It says, "Love, let love be without hypocrisy." Now, what's that mean? Just stop right there. It means that let love be sincere. Let it be genuine. Let it be real. Okay? You know, it's almost funny that, you know, you see some of these shows where, you know, two ladies come up and they kiss on the cheek, like, you know, and they don't even come close to each other, you know. It's like you got bad breath, and, you know. I mean, it's like, but it's like a social, you know, thing. Is that love? Do we just tolerate people and things like that? Is love that? No. Love without hypocrisy. Genuine caring. Sincere. Real. Then it says, abhor what is evil. Another word for abhor is to hate. Another word for that is to be repelled by. Okay? We should be repelled by, repulsed by those things that are evil. If you look at the TV, and, you know, it's getting harder and harder, and the movies that are out, so many things about occult things and all these other things, and it says things that are so evil in nature, does it have a place in our heart that we are a little repulsed by it? You know? There was a very old movie, and, you know, maybe I'm showing my age. It was called Clockwork Orange. And it was talking about how they reconditioned this individual who kind of laughed at all the hateful things that were going on. And they actually physically made him sick when they made him look at something, and then they attached it to a physical feeling. You know, they reset this clock within himself. But you see, we as believers need to see clearly what God is seeing. And the whole thing of evil, we need to be able to really be repulsed by it, abhor it, hate it. But then it goes on and says, and cling to that which is good. You know, in Philippians it talks about, you know, things that are right, and all those things that are good. You know, think on these things, you know. When it says cling to that which is good, it really means, when it says cling, it means hold on with all your might, like you're holding on to a life ring and being dragged to safety. Hello? If I'm grounding, okay, and somebody throws me something that's going to save me, that life ring, I'm going to hold on to that, man, with everything I've got till they pull me in to safety. It says cling to it, hold on to it, give it all your strength, Cling to that which is good. Don't let anybody rip it away from you. Don't let anybody take you away from the good things that God is. The Bible also says, taste and see that the Lord is good. We need to know that when we taste what God is, when we experience what God is, when we have the presence of God in our life, when the Spirit of God sweeps over our soul and we understand that we are forgiven and that we are redeemed, means bought back. What a great feeling. We just sang that song again. Since Jesus came into my heart, what a wonderful joy is in my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. There's things that I'd forgotten all about since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came in. Do you remember that moment when Jesus came into your heart? I have to say that there were times in my life when Jesus came into my heart. I was only a little kid, probably about 6 years old, when I first remember coming to the altar and having the evangelist put their hand on my head and pray and say, let Jesus come into your heart. I was only a little kid, but it gave me peace and joy. Later on, as a young person, I felt the conviction of God and came up and was prayed for again. As a young teenager, it happened again. As an older teenager, it happened again. All different times in our life, it comes to that point of repentance, just like John the Baptist called people to repent, just like Jesus called people to repent, that we come back. And we cling to that which is good. Oh, man. Ooh, the presence of God. Do you remember when David sinned and that he had slept with, you know, Bathsheba? That he had, you know, been an adulterer. He had done all these different things. He had been a murderer. And he finally confesses to God. You know, he says, clean me with hyssop. He says, but don't. Please, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. I can't stand to be away from the presence of you, Lord. Don't turn your back on me. Don't, Lord God. You see, the thing that we look at as believers is this, that we turn towards God and we're in this relationship with God and we turn to those things which are good and we're clinging on to it, and God doesn't turn his back on us. We turn our back on him. It's about time that we as the church start to turn our backs on the world and turn towards Christ. You've seen that song or heard that song, I've decided to follow Jesus. You know, the cross before me, the world behind me. We sing that chorus, we sing that particular verse. The cross is before us, and we look as we move in our lives towards the cross. And I will not let go of that, and I will move towards that, that is my motivation, that's where I'm going, and the world can be behind me. I'm not going to look at it. But how many times do we kind of look over our shoulders? You know? Lot's wife. Don't look back. Once you get going, keep going. So you look back. We're told to not look back on these things. We are to cling to those things which are good and holy and right. Verse 10 goes on. It says, devoting one another to in brotherly love. What it's here saying, not just the general worldview, but those who are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we who are in the body of Christ, you see, in the verses before, and I've kind of skipped over, that we are all one in the body. We all have different jobs to do here in the body of Christ, but we are all part of the body of Christ. You know, some of us don't want to be a foot. Some of us want to be a hand. Some of us want to be an eye and an ear or whatever. But you see, we all have a job to do. We all have a particular place. We all have a calling on our life. We all have a purpose that God has put into our life. And it says here that we should be devoted one to another in brotherly love. Living in preference to one another, in honor, in respect of one another. Just because somebody doesn't have the same gift that you have, you should respect them in the church. They're not all preachers. They're not all teachers. They're all not prophets. They don't prophesy and do these other things. But what they do is we have a job to do. Do we have hospitality? I tell you what, I probably gained a lot of weight when I went over to my pastor's house every Sunday. And you'd go in there, and if you were hungry or not, here, eat, manja, manja, here. You know, it was like to be fed. You stop over in the afternoon. Oh, have a cup of coffee. Here, have a... I mean, I don't care what time of the day or night it was. See, it was hospitality put out there to give you something. You know, we need to know that that is another gift of the Spirit. This is another thing that God does with us. And we need to honor one another. We need to be respectful to one another. We need to be able to understand that even though we have a weaker brother or sister, they're our brothers and sisters. We also need to respect those people who are older. You know, in the world today, I see it so many times on the news, some older person gets, you know, hit, punched, kicked, you know, not even for doing anything wrong, not even face to face, this from the back and all these other things. And what respect of age is there with that? Do we honor one another? You need to know that we as the church really need to be able to look out after each other. And sometimes it's not easy, is it? Sometimes it's very difficult to do stuff. But we need to know that when Jesus was asked about how many times we need to forgive, well, how many times do I need to forgive my brother, Lord? 3 times? 5 times? 7 times? How often do I have to forgive him? It's getting a little annoying. And Jesus says, 70 times 7. Huh? What? You see, we need to be able to forgive. If we have been forgiven, if we have had such a debt lifted up from our shoulders, why can't we forgive those around us? Jesus said that about forgiving our brother. There's also the parable of the servant. When we are forgiven such wonderfully by our master in our sins, why can we not forgive? We need to honor and forgive. It says, verse 11, not lacking behind in diligence, fervent in spirit in serving the Lord. Okay? Don't lack. But this ties right into it, verse 12. 3 parts. Rejoicing in hope. Hope. It's not an assurance thing. It's not the pie in the sky by and by. It's hope in the Lord. It's not in the surroundings that we're in. It's in the promises of God. It's in the Word of God. Our hope, my hope is built on nothing less than what? Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest fame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. That's where my hope is. It says, rejoice in your hope. Persevere through tribulation. Jesus didn't tell us that everything's fine. No, he says, in this world you will have tribulation. What, Lord? Can't you take care of that yourself? Lord, can't we just get past that? No, in this world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. With Jesus, we can overcome that tribulation. We can persevere through tribulation. And this is the part that is interesting to me, that it puts it right at the end of this little verse. Devoted to prayer. When you're having a hard time, pray. When you're having victory, pray. When you're concerned, pray. When you're confused, pray. Whenever you have a question, pray. Whenever God gives you an answer, pray. Pray is the conversation that we have with God. It is an ongoing thing. The Bible tells us that we are to pray without ceasing. Walking down the road, we should be praying. Before you get in that argument with somebody, okay, slow to speak. Bite your tongue. Pray. Sometimes we don't do that. I'm not perfect, I'll tell you what. there are times when I get set off and, God help me, you know? Well, that's what we should be saying. Because we can't do it on our own. When we have these things to persevere, to have hope, devote yourself to prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Practicing hospitality. There we go with what I was telling you about, hospitality. Contribute to the needs of the saints. If you can help somebody out, do it. Now, that doesn't mean be foolish in giving and everything else, but the whole thing is to the saints, to believers, to your brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, we need to know that we are a part of the same body. Not too many years ago, there was a case of a murder that took place. One brother shot the other brother. The only problem was that they were conjoined twins. The brother had gotten so mad at his brother that he took a gun and he shot him in the head, killing his brother. Not even thinking about the fact that they were conjoined twins, and as he did that, he killed himself. You see, we need to know that this anger that we can have generating into our lives, we need to be concerned about doing things. The saints are the body of Christ. When we are part of the body, when one part of the body hurts, we all hurt. It goes on into one of these verses that says, we rejoice with those who rejoice in verse 15. We weep with those who weep. You see, we are a part of the body of the concern. We read it each month in our covenant. We are a body of the concern. We are a part of the church. We are a part of the body of Christ. And sometimes we don't understand it. You're going to a family reunion, right, Rick? Does everybody always get along? No. We just had our whole family together and everything else. And there are different political views and different things and different areas of people's life. But thank God we kind of made it through. And if you haven't been around little kids very much, you know, they're great, but then all of a sudden they start to rub on your nerves, you know? We need to know that all of these things, we're all part of that body. We're all part of this plan that God has. And we need to understand it, and that we do rejoice. It says, verse 14, please look at it. I have it accented, highlighted here. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. I think that a lot of us should put that on your dashboard. Hello? Did you see that idiot? He was going to pull out on me and blah, blah, blah. Did you see whatever? He's, why is he going so fast? Why is he going so slow? Why is... Really? There shouldn't be a truck over here. Blah, blah, blah. If you think that they are trying to persecute you, you know, it's all in your perspective. You need to look at what that really persecution is. Persecution is the world looking at us and taking these things. The world today tries to call black white and white black, good evil and evil good, sweet bitter and bitter sweet. The opposites are constantly being mixed up, and they try to make you believe that. Really? We need to know what the Word of God says. We need to know the plan of God. And that the peace that passes all understanding does not come from the world. Jesus told his disciples before he was leaving, he says, peace I leave with you. Listen to this part. Not as the world giveth, give I unto thee. Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid. Boy, I tell you what, before you watch the news, let your heart not be afraid. Peace I give to you. Not the world giving me peace, but God giving me peace. When people are saying persecuting you, are they persecuting you for Christ's sake? In Matthew 5, in the Beatitudes, it says, blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. That's Jesus speaking. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. For in this way they persecuted the prophets that came before you. We're not anything different. There is going to be persecution. There is going to be problems. But great is your reward in heaven, and great is the presence of God. Again, Paul was kind of crazy. I look at Paul and say, whoa. You know, some people say, oh, to be like Paul. No, I don't think I really want to be like Paul. You know, oh, to be beaten for Christ. Oh, what a wonderful thing to be able to be beaten and serve my master. Oh, to be imprisoned for Christ's sake. I am not a prisoner of Rome. I'm a prisoner of Christ. They said, shut up or we'll kill you. Oh, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Oh, that would be such a great gain. Do we look at life in the steps that we are moving towards eternity, towards the plan that God has for our life? How long are you going to live? I don't know. But if I live today, I live for Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who liveth in me. I had an older person, and they told me this, and I've used it before, and about serving God. They said, if you're not dead, you're not done. Hello? If you're not dead, you're not done. Continue to serve God. Well, how can you serve Him? There's lots of ways to serve God. I tell a lot of stories, and I tell them again, so you'll have to put up with me. But there was an old lady who was getting up in age, and she was in a lot of pain. She had arthritis and had a lot of different pains and joints and things, and she kept coming to church. And her daughter finally said, Mom, you've been in church all your life and everything else, and maybe it's time just to take a little break and to not go to church. You know, you don't have to stress and struggle to get up to church. She goes, oh no. It says, me sitting there in church is an example to other people that they don't have an excuse to not be in church. Because if I'm not there, then they say, well, she's not there. I can have an excuse to not be there. You know? Wow. She says, I want to be a testimony. I want people to see me that I have made an effort to be in the house of the Lord. I remember sitting right back there. Bob would struggle to come up. Bob Higgins would struggle to get up those stairs. We didn't have this ramp over here. We had these stairs up front. And he struggled, and I mean struggled, to get up those stairs. It would take him a while to get up those stairs. And his wife, Geneva, would be behind him, like, you know, don't fall, don't fall, don't fall. And he would get up and he would sit there. And every time we'd have a time for testimony, remember? He would get himself up. And he would say, I just want to give God glory and give some kind of testimony about something. Did that make an impression on me? Sure did. Did that make an impression on the people else around? Sure did. Was he being persecuted? Well, in a way, he was being hurt by the disease and things that he had in his life. But he was going to give God. He says, rejoice with those who rejoice. So when he would give a testimony, I'd rejoice with him. And when he was in pain, I'd weep with him. You see, we need to be a body of the concerned. We need to know that our whole move of the Spirit is towards what God's plan is for us. Look what it says in verse 16. Be of the same mind toward one another. Be in harmony. You know, one of the things that we learned in choir is when you're singing a song, listen to the person next to you. And sometimes we need to be tuned. We need to change just a little bit. Well, who's off? It doesn't matter who's off. It just matters that you're together, that you're in harmony. Harmony does not mean singing the same note. Hello? You know, some of my music, it's harmony is coming together, and it has overtones, and it blesses, and it sounds so good together. This harmony is building a whole thing together. And sometimes we need to be tuned. Sometimes we need to be tightened, just like a guitar string, just until we hear the right thing. We need to have this. We need to be in harmony with each other, towards one another. Not haughty and you're like, well, I got the right note. They better make the change. Really? You got the right note. Hello? How about coming together? We need to listen. We need to be able to come together. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate those in lowly places. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Well, I have the right answer. I have the right word. I have the right... Really? God forbid that I would be haughty, that would say, hey, if you don't do things the way I do it, you're wrong. That's not what the Word of God says. It says here that we can't be haughty. We need to associate with each other. We need to be not wise in our own mind. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not to your own understanding. Acknowledging Him in all of your ways. Acknowledging Him in all of your ways. Yeah, Lord, I got this one figured out. I got it from here. Really? Be careful. Be careful. This part is number 17. Please look at it. It says, never repay evil for evil to anyone. Not returning evil. In Peter, it says the same thing, that we don't return evil for evil. Boy, do you learn lessons from your grandkids. My granddaughter is the oldest one, Melody, and she's bigger than all the other grandkids. And sometimes, you know, with a younger sister, you know, she gets a little bit of, you know. And her mom taught her and told her, says, honey, if your sister does something wrong, you can't return evil for evil. When she does something wrong. Well, not too long ago, her little sister came up to her, Melody, got her mad about something, and she came up and her little sister just pushed her down to the ground. And she looked up at her sister and says, Mommy says, I should never return evil for evil. And I said, wow. She remembered it, so she didn't respond in anger. She didn't do something. And praise God. Now, sometimes she does, but at least you remember that time. We need to all. You ever get pushed down? Oh, really? Don't return evil for evil. I taught my granddaughter to say something every morning, and I think you guys can say it every morning too. When she gets up, she says, I'm strong. I'm smart. I'm special. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Just when we were up in Maine, she goes, you know, Papa, you know, she was having a hard day, and having some problems with her other nieces and nephews and things. So I said, hey, did you say that today? And she goes, no, but she said it. And I said, and what's the next part? And she says, and treat others the way that I want to be treated. I said, is that the way that you would want to be treated? Well, I sometimes forget that. And Papa? I said, yeah. You know the verse that comes before that? But I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Doesn't that cover the ability to do the other part? And I'm sitting there going, what do you mean? Well, to be able to treat other people the way that I want to be treated, I need God to help me be strengthened. And I'm sitting there going, whoa, what an eye-opening theological point that this little six-year-old brought to me. I need that part. I need God strengthening me to be able to treat other people that way. I need God's strength and ability so that I won't be able to return evil for evil. That I will treat people that way. That I will have hope. That I will be able to get through tribulation. That I will be able to pray and to talk to God. That I will pull all of these things together. This is where we need to be. So we can learn from a child. Isn't it amazing that sometimes God uses things to turn us around and see what we need to know? If they can get it, why can't I get it? We need to know that we never, never, never pay back evil for evil. You know, Martin Luther King said that, and it's the last verse here. It says, "And do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." He says, you know, hate can't get rid of hate. Only love can get rid of hate. Darkness can't get rid of darkness. Only light can get rid of darkness. We need to know that we can't be overcome by evil, but we need to overcome that evil with good, the good that God has planned for us. We need to respect all men. It goes on in verse 17, to respect that which is right in the sight of all men. And verse 18 is very, very hard. This is one that I have highlighted. I have it in dark print. I have it underlined. If possible, so far as depending on you, be at peace with all men. I looked at that and I said, oh, I've seen that one before, Lord. If it's possible, you know, I'll be at peace with all men. You know, but they better get it right. He had me go back and underline and look at it. No. As depending upon you. Hello? It depends on you, not upon them. You're going to have peace with them? Yeah, I'm going to have, if possible. But it depends on you to have that peace. You need to have that peace. Don't put the blame on other people. In verse 19, it says, don't take revenge. Leave room for the wrath of God, which is written, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay. That's also in Deuteronomy. That's where it came from. It's not ours to judge. It's God is the judge. We are not the judge. If we were forgiven, if we have been a sinner saved by grace, if God has poured out grace upon us, amazing grace, how sweet the sound, if God has shown that grace towards us, why can't we show more grace towards those people around us? Why can't we be more forgiving? Why can't we live a life like Christ wants us to live? Has God given you grace and mercy? Sure has with me. Has he forgiven you time and time again? Sure has. Keith Green sang a song, and it's a song that I think about every now and then. It says, Lord, it's me again. I don't know if I can confess this same old sin. Lord, hello, it's me again. Please take me back yet again. Are we to that point where we can go to him? Or are we so, oh, he can't save me now. He can't forgive me now. Really? We need to be at peace. And the peace that we have, we need to share with those around us. Verse 20 says this, and this is tough. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing so, you heap coals on their head. Some people take that and say, oh man, I'll get them back. You think I'm being nice, but I'm just putting coals on. It's not saying that. Because if they can't receive it, then there's a problem. Because when you give out of love and concern, when you do these things, you're giving them no excuse. You don't have to, it's the old thing we say, you don't hate the sinner, you hate the sin. You know, it's the things in their life. You don't accept that, but you don't hate them. If they don't know any better, tell them about Jesus. More and more and more, I do what my friend does. Has anybody told you today that Jesus loves you? And people don't know how to respond. They kind of smile and say, no, nobody told me that. Well, he does. And they said, I received that. I said, praise God. See, we need to know that we share these things. Putting that on somebody to say that you're blessed, that you're forgiven, that in spite of somebody being nasty to you, you smile and you're nice back to them. You see, we need to know that it can't overcome evil with evil. We can only overcome evil with good. I'm going to end with just one quick little story. I was coaching football, and there was this young man who was always seemed to be very angry. Very angry. And one day after practice, I was getting ready to go home, and I walked by him. And I just smiled. I just smiled at him. And he says, go to hell. And I said, well, just to let you know, I'm not going to hell. And he says, well, I am. And all my friends will be there, and we'll be drinking beer and having a great old party. So go to hell. I said, okay, I'll be praying for you. I just smiled and walked away. That weekend, that young man and another young man went out and had a case of beer in the back of their truck and ran into a telephone pole, killed them both. The last thing I said to him was just what I told him. The devil is a liar and a deceiver, and we need to know that people need to know the truth, that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that the wages of sin is death, that God loved us so much that Jesus died on the cross while we were yet sinners. All of these things. And then as we become the believers, as we become part of the body, as we become something to join together, we all have a job to do. And as we come here, we have a blessed hope. We have a joy. And we have the presence of God in our life to be overcomers. Last verse, I'm going to say it again and close it. Do not be overcome by evil. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord God, through the foolishness of preaching, Lord God, I pray that you will touch people's hearts. Help them to see your plan of salvation and your plan of us all serving you, to be a part of the body of Christ, whatever that part of the body is that you have for us. Help us, Lord God, to love one another. Help us, Lord God, to never pay back evil for evil. Help us to rejoice with those who rejoice. Help us to weep with those who weep. Help us through persecution to not curse, but to bless other people. Lord God, help us to truly love the way that you have loved us. For the commandment that you gave right before you left, you said, love one another as I have loved you. It's a hard thing for us to do, but we thank you and praise you and help us, Lord God, to love as you have loved us. Amen. Join in singing 394. Savior and Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.
Yes, one more thing. I just was told by some people that Rick's birthday was yesterday. Oh. So can you play happy birthday, Emma?
Happy birthday.
To you, Rick.
Can you play? Happy birthday.
Can you play happy birthday?